Hello, I'm Josh Demude, and welcome to the eighth lecture of Unit 3, Network Flows and Matchings. We're nearly done. In this eighth lecture, we will be looking at the maximum cardinality matching problem in bipartite graphs. So we defined this problem in last lecture. Please do go back and watch that if you haven't yet. Here, we're going to be looking at how to solve this problem efficiently in a special case of graphs called bipartite graphs. So let's go ahead and define those bipartite graphs. A bipartite graph, G equals, and then we have two sets of nodes that make up our node set and then edges. These kinds of graphs have the property that every edge has one endpoint in A and one endpoint in B. Specifically, there are no edges going between nodes in A, and there are no edges going between nodes in B. They all go from one side to the other. And this setup of A and B is often called the bipartition. Partition because it's split into two groups, bipartition because there are two groups. So a thing to notice about these graphs is whenever we look at a node, little a in A, so say this top node here, then its neighbors denoted by capital N of A are all in B. Right? Any neighbors it could possibly have must be on the other side because there are no edges between nodes in A. Likewise, for any node in B, all of its neighbors must be in A. It turns out that maximum cardinality matching is easier to solve in a bipartite graph than it is in general. So just to build some intuition, we're going to start off by studying this problem in this simpler setting. There's a famous theorem in graph theory called Hall's theorem. It says, let G be an undirected bipartite graph. Then G has a matching covering A if and only if this condition is true. So let's break down the second sentence here. First of all, it's an if and only if, right? So this is exactly what an optimality criterion is. We can go either direction, and in its proof, we would need to show both directions. What is a matching covering A? Well, in last lecture, we defined what it meant for a matching to cover something. It means that when you look at all of the edges, every node in capital A, so in this left-hand side, must be the endpoint of some edge in the matching. So there shouldn't be anybody left out. If G has such a matching that covers everybody in A, then this complicated technical condition is true. And I think it's easiest to understand if we draw a picture. Let's suppose that we chose these three nodes here in the middle as our set S. Note that this has to be true for every subset S, but we're just going to do one to start off with as an example. This condition is relating the number of nodes in S, which in our case is three, to the number of neighbors of S. So, okay, what is this set here? The neighbors are just the unions of all of the neighborhoods of each individual node in S. So you'll notice like that this top node in S has two neighbors. It has this one, and it has this one. The middle node in S has two neighbors, the same top one, and then a different bottom one. And likewise, the third and final node of S has two neighbors, the one straight across and the one down. So when we talk about the neighborhood of a set of nodes, we're talking about the union of all of these things, which happens to be these four nodes in B. So here it's saying if there are at least as many neighbors as there are nodes in the set S, and that is true for every single S we could have chosen, then there must be a matching covering A, and vice versa. If there's a matching covering A, then this condition must be true. The proof of this theorem is a little bit involved. It's in your proof supplement, and we will be going over it in class. I don't really want to say too much about it now, but we can talk about the easy direction. Imagine that there was some set S for which this condition was not true. Okay, well, what does it mean for this to not be true? It means that the number of neighbors of a set is strictly less than the number of nodes we actually started with. So in this example, you could imagine we picked these three nodes S, and then maybe with different edges, maybe the green N of S was only two neighbors, let's just say, right? So three neighbors on the left, but only three nodes on the left, but only two neighbors on the right. It should be very clear that this is a huge problem for trying to find a matching that covers everything in A. Well, why is that? It's because we're saying, if we were to match up, you know, if we were to try, and there were three nodes on the left and only two on the right, how are we supposed to match three with two? There's only two neighbors to actually pair up with. So clearly, at least one of those nodes is always going to be left out, because the other two will take all of its neighbors and it won't have anyone left. So that direction of this proof is very, very easy. It's easy to show that if this condition is not true, then G does not have a matching covering A. It's the other direction that's a little bit harder, and I encourage you to read through the proof supplement and really understand what's happening in that proof. There's a special case of Hall's theorem called Frobenius's theorem. Frobenius's theorem extends this to specifically perfect matchings. So we'll read the theorem first. If G is an undirected bipartite graph, then G has a perfect matching if and only if the number of nodes in A is equal to the number of nodes in B. And once again, we have this condition from Hall's theorem. So to unpack this, we need a little bit of background. Remember from unit zero, a perfect matching is a matching that covers every node in the entire graph. Okay, what Frobenius's theorem is saying is you can only get a matching that covers every node in the entire bipartite graph if the number of nodes in A is equal to the number of nodes in B, which is true in this particular example that I've drawn here, and if Hall's condition holds. It's clear, of course, that if Hall's condition holds, then G has a matching covering A, right? So if G has a matching covering A, then to get a perfect matching, we just also need a matching that covers B. And of course, that's going to be true if they have the same size. So Frobenius's theorem does not really have a proof of its own. It's simply Hall's theorem in a special case. Now, I claimed that maximum cardinality matching was easier in this whole bipartite world. Let's go ahead and show why that's the case. So maximum cardinality matching can be solved in graphs of N nodes and M edges in this polynomial time. And let's see why. Well, I'm not going to do the whole proof written out, but we can draw a picture that's pretty convincing. So let's start with a bipartite graph, A and B, which has some edges. We're going to transform this graph in the following way. First, we're going to add a source node S, and we're going to add new edges from S to every node in A. And specifically, this is going to be a directed graph. So we direct all edges from S to the nodes in A. Then we change the undirected edges between A and B to be directed, where everything goes from A to B. So you see the arrows are pointing in that direction. And finally, we add a sink T, and we add new edges from each node in B to T, directed from B to T. Next, we assign edge capacities to all of these things. So for us, for this purpose, edge capacity 1 will work perfectly fine. Then we run Edmonds-Karp on this thing. So Edmonds-Karp from a few lectures ago is an algorithm for maximum ST flows, right? And clearly S is on the left, T is on the right here. And the only way we can get from S to T is by using some of the edges that were in the original graph, right, before we did this transformation. So in this particular case, I've colored all of the edges used by the flow in blue. So we can see that actually in this particular case, it's possible to find a perfect matching, or rather one that covers every single possible node in the graph. And this happens in polynomial time, because Edmonds-Karp runs in polynomial time. The last thing we have to do is get our matching out of this. Well, all you do is you just chop off S and T. They weren't part of the original graph anyway. And we say that the matching that is maximum in the original graph is equal to when we looked at the flow, it's all those edges that were carrying flow one from A to B. So going back one step, you see those are the edges that were included in the flow. We just take their undirected versions to obtain the maximum matching. Okay, so that concludes our brief introduction to matchings in the simple case of bipartite matchings. In the next lecture, we will conclude the entire unit by looking at how to solve the maximum cardinality matching problem in the case of general graphs, so where we don't necessarily have this nice bipartition, but where the graph could look however it wants to look.